Revelation, as I've said before, is the principal book of prophecy in the New Testament of the Bible.
Gerald Fleury.
Greetings, everyone. Last week, I talked to you about the Ark of the Covenant and how it was going to be discovered in this end time, according to the prophet Jeremiah. And it is going to cause quite a public excitement when that happens. Today, I want to talk to you about the tombs of the kings, because they too are prophesied to be found in this end time and cause a world sensation. Both of these events are prophesied in the book of Jeremiah. And it's something you need to be concerned about because it is going to impact your life. Christ told us that we ought to live by every word of God. And he also asked, well, when the Son of Man comes, shall he find faith on earth? And of course, the answer was, well, there's going to be a world crisis in faith. People are not going to believe God. They're not going to believe His Word. Now, that is the worst crisis of all when you understand it spiritually. The tombs of the kings are going to be found just before the tribulation and the second coming of Jesus Christ. The righteous kings who sat on David's throne are actually buried in a massive tomb. You can see that in your Bible. Probably a tomb with many rooms, certainly with a lot of the all of the righteous kings buried there alongside David and Solomon. Now, a small part of David's palace has already been discovered. And every indication is those tombs are right under David's palace or very close to it. And they're going to be found. The Apostle Peter, when he was on this earth in the first century, said that it was just common knowledge that everybody knew where David's sepulcher or tomb was. Everybody knew. But why is it nobody knows today? Not specifically, but the problem is there was a time when people were trying to get into those tombs, and did on a couple occasions, and then when they tried to go even further, two men were struck dead, according to Josephus, the famous Jewish historian of the first century, and an outstanding one at that. Two men were struck dead. And that caused so much fear that nobody ever attempted after that to enter the tombs of the kings. Nobody, because there was such fear of God. Now, there's a reason why God did that. Somehow, one way or the other, God caused those men to be slain because He did not want those tombs opened then and destroyed. That's all prophesied to happen in this end time, right out of the book of Jeremiah. And yet, I don't think you'll ever hear anybody really speaking on this, perhaps, except this work. But why not? It is, after all, in the book of Jeremiah, and Jeremiah is an end time book. So why shouldn't we talk about it? Let me read to you something that my son wrote about the tombs of the kings. And he's quoting Josephus here, that famous Jewish historian of the first century. Notice what he said. First of all, the Jews who returned to Jerusalem from Babylonian exile were well aware of the tombs and their location. You can see that in Nehemiah 3 in verse 16, when they came back to build the second temple. It was there and people knew where they were. But Josephus, writing in the first century A.D., describes David's burial and his tomb this way. Quote, "He was buried by his son Solomon in Jerusalem with great magnificence and with all the other funeral pomp which kings are used to be buried with. Moreover, he had great and immense wealth buried with him." Josephus goes on to describe the first known raid of David's tomb by Johann Hyrcanus, the high priest. He was besieged by Antiochus, that was called Pius, when he was desirous of giving him money to get him to raise the siege. So this high priest grew fearful and didn't trust God. And he opened the room of David's sepulcher and took out 3,000 talents. Now, but as Josephus tells us, Hyrcanus only raided one room of the tombs. 100 years later, King Herod determined to pick up where Hyrcanus left off. And notice what he did. As for any money, he found none, as Hyrcanus had done, but the furniture of gold and those precious goods that were laid up there, all which he took away. So he took some precious goods out of the tombs of the kings. Now we'll go on and read a little more of Josephus just to conclude this. But here's what Josephus wrote. He had a great desire to make a more diligent search and to go farther, even as far as the very bodies of David and Solomon. That is in the time of Herod. He wanted to go further now than he did the first time. And notice what happened. There were two of his guards were slain by a flame that burst out upon those who went in, as the report was. It was just a flame that burst out and destroyed those two men. Now, who do you suppose inflicted that pain on those men and that death? Well, obviously God did it, because it was that those tombs were prophesied to be opened and destroyed in this end time by Jeremiah, not at that time. And this concludes by saying, "So he was terribly frightened and went out and built a monument of that," or kind of a door to block that, a monument of that fright he had been in, and this of white stone as the mouth of the sepulcher, and that at great expense also. So here were two of Herod's guards that were going to go in there, right in where Solomon and David were buried in the many tombs there. And God struck him dead, because of what they did. And it brought great fear into the mind of Herod and others. And that frightened them so much that there's no record of anybody attempting to get into those tombs after that. And today they don't even know where they are. But I can tell you from the Bible almost precisely, the Bible and secular history, almost precisely where those tombs of the kings are. And you are going to see that they are going to be found in this end time. And it's going to cause quite an uproar. It's also going to fill some people with rage who are the enemies of the Jews. But why would God do all of that? Well, because all of this was prophesied to happen in this end time, and God wasn't about to let men to in any way interfere with His plan. Notice Jeremiah 30. Let me just give you a little background here on Jeremiah. Jeremiah 30 and verse 1 says, "The word that came to Jeremiah from the Eternal, saying, Thus speaks the Lord God of Israel, saying, Write you all the words that I have spoken unto you in a book, For lo, the days come, not that day, but the days are coming, says the Eternal, that I will bring again the captivity of my people Israel and Judah, says the Eternal, and I will cause them to return to the land that I gave to their fathers, and so on. So it goes on to say in verse 7 that there's no time of suffering ever like this that is going to be coming upon them, which is called Jacob's trouble. And then in verse 9, it goes on to talk about how David is going to be resurrected to be king over Israel at that time. Obviously, it's the very end time and just before the second coming of Jesus Christ to this earth. Now let's look at that prophecy that is so earth-shaking and ought to get a lot of people's attention, but it doesn't seem to because, well, when the Son of Man comes, shall he find faith on this earth? Not very much. That's the answer God gives. Notice verse 32 of Jeremiah 7. Therefore, behold, the days come, says the Eternal, that it shall no more be called Tophet, nor the valley of the son of Hinnom, but the valley of slaughter. For they shall bury in Tophet till there be no place. In other words, there's no place left to bury people. If you can imagine that, how bad is that going to be? How much should that concern us today? Well, it's for this end time. We ought to be thinking about it in the age of these weapons of mass destruction. We ought to be thinking about what God says is coming upon this world and how He's going to solve it by the second coming of Jesus Christ. Verse 33, and the carcasses of this people shall be meat for the fowls of the heaven and for the beasts of the earth, and none shall fray them away. Then will I cause to cease from the cities of Judah and from the streets of Jerusalem the voice of mirth or joy. It's just going to be gone. No more joy. And the voice of gladness and the voice of the bridegroom and the voice of the bride, for the land shall be desolate. No happy marriages. It's really going to be very bad. I don't know how you could explain it as getting much worse than what is prophesied here. And why doesn't this concern men enough to dig into these prophecies and learn to believe God, because what He prophesies always comes to pass. It always comes to pass. Now, this is specifically aimed at Judah and Jerusalem in the Middle East. That's what this prophecy is about. It's the overall prophecy was to Israel and Judah. Judah is actually a part of Israel, but they were separated from them when the lost 10 tribes rebelled and then became the lost 10 tribes. But I tell you, this is a tremendous emphasis on what an archaeologist is going to find in this end time. Tremendous emphasis on this prophecy. Notice now what it says here, and it's one of the strangest prophecies in all the Bible in a way, and one that it really gets almost no attention. Verse 1 of chapter 8 of Jeremiah, and there should be no chapter break there. It should flow right on because it's the same prophecy. At that time, says the Eternal, they shall bring out the bones of the kings of Judah and the bones of the princes and the bones of the priests and the bones of the prophets and the bones of the inhabitants of Jerusalem out of their graves. So the inhabitants here, the last word inhabitants, actually is talking about the inhabitants sitting there with a throne, whether it be a king or a prophet or a prince. It just means inhabitants that will sit on a throne and do some kind of judging. Gesenius tells you that. Also, here's one definition from Gesenius' Hebrew and Chaldee lexicon. Especially, to sit is used of a judges, where they sit to give judgment. Psalm 9 and verse 5, kings sitting on their throne. Psalm 9 and verse 8 and 55 and verse 20. And Isaiah 10 and verse 13, where it talks about kings doing that. And that's those are the inhabitants that Jeremiah is talking about. But notice then, now here they've discovered all the bones of these kings, and somebody is bringing the bones of all of those kings out of the tombs that have been found. They were discovered in this end time, immediately ahead of us. And then verse 2, and they shall spread them before the sun and the moon and the host of heaven. That is the ruler of all everything, the heaven, the earth, the angels. Spread them out, whom they have loved. That is, these righteous kings love God. And these people that are coming in there into Jerusalem hate what God says in His Word. And this is in the Great Tribulation, when this all happens, after they have found them just before the Great Tribulation. But notice this verse continues, and whom they have served, and after whom they have walked, and whom they have sought, and whom they have worshipped, they shall not be gathered nor be buried. They shall be for dung upon the face of the earth. So God let them just go in there and destroy the bones of those righteous kings to try to teach the Jews and two other nations of Israel, talked about in our book on the United States and Britain in prophecy, and they're going to be facing some dire consequences of all of their terrible sins. And this is going to end with the second coming of Jesus Christ. But look, you can't go in there and bring out the bones of those kings unless you know where they are, unless the whole world knows where they are. Or at least there's going to be a spectacular sensation in this world when those bones of the kings are found. I mean, that tells you everything about who Israel is and who Judah is and where they are. And it tells you all kinds of things about their history. But the tombs of the kings have not been seen for nearly 2,000 years. And yet I can tell you they're about to be found because of what Jeremiah prophesied. Why can't people believe God? Well, you see why we're having so many problems in this world. People don't believe God. They don't have faith to believe in every word of God, which Christ said we should. And that's what a Christian is supposed to be, one that follows Christ and believes Him when He said, live by every word of God. But here, the enemies of the Jews are having a heyday, and they are in a rage about what these findings and these discoveries in archaeology, and they know it's contrary to what they want to believe, and they want to destroy all of them. It's a thrilling event to the world when these bones are found, and especially to the Jews. But if you understand the prophecy of Psalm 83, and we will send you information about that if you'd like to have it, but it says there that they're going to go after the Jews and, actually three nations of Israel, and try to blot out their name forever. That's the spirit behind the destruction of those bones of the kings, the righteous kings of Judah. And it's contrary to what God is would have them do, but God is allowing it and bringing it upon them because of their sins. Clark's commentary says, look, there's no chapter break here. He can see that the flow is there. It's just one continual prophecy. And he wrote this. It says they're taking out those bones like that, quote, was the highest expression of hatred and contempt. The highest expression of hatred and contempt. Well, now, that's something to think about. Why would they have all of that hatred for the Jews and for, frankly, America and Britain as well? Why would they want to blot out the history of righteous kings in Judah? Well, it's because they're being inspired and moved by Satan the devil, and Queen Elizabeth today sits on David's throne, and you can easily prove that in our book on the United States and Britain and prophecy. She sits on David's throne. And God promised David that that throne would be on this earth forever. And certainly the kings are going to be sitting on that throne all the way up to the second coming of Christ, and then Christ's going to sit on it for all eternity. That throne is not going away regardless of how much Satan hates it and wants to blot out all that information. It isn't going to happen. Just the reverse is going to happen. Our Key of David booklet will explain that to you. We also have some articles on archaeology that we'll offer you at the end of this program, and also a short article on the tombs of the kings written by my son. And it's information where he's just quoting from Josephus and other historians and the Bible. But notice verse 3 of this chapter 8 of Jeremiah, "And death shall be chosen rather than life by all the residue of them that remain." Do we realize what this earth is about to enter into? People would choose death rather than life because it's so horrifying. And there's so much atrocious evil being inflicted on people on this earth. And it's all because of their sins. Well, you can read the rest of that, but it's a very important verse and says a great deal. Now, let me just read to you from 1 Kings 11, verse 43, to prove to you more about why these kings are buried together in one massive tomb, which is probably right under the palace of David, which has already been found. 10 to 15% of it has already been excavated, and the rest of it is going to begin to be excavated very quickly. And it's all there in the city of David or Jerusalem. But Solomon slept with his fathers, it says in 1 Kings 11, verse 43. He slept with his fathers and was buried in the city of David, his father. That's Jerusalem. But who are the fathers? Well, the fathers are David and Solomon and those other righteous kings that sat on David's throne throughout history, like Queen Elizabeth. And the righteous ones are going to be, it said, were in the past buried with their fathers. Now, it's been a while since we have had the kind of righteousness that God is looking for. But notice 1 Kings 15 and verse 24. I'll just quickly read this to you. King Asa slept with his fathers and was buried with his fathers in the city of David, his father. Now, he's right there with David, his father, and the other fathers. And these are the tombs of the kings that I'm talking about. 1 Kings 22 and verse 50, King Jehoshaphat slept with his fathers and was buried with his fathers in the city of David, his father. So you can see the evil one, the kings, were in the city of David, but not sleeping with their fathers. They didn't deserve that honor. So here we have some amazing knowledge. And if you look at Acts 2 and verse 29, let me quickly read that to you. "Men and brethren, let me freely speak unto you of the patriarch David, that he is both dead and buried, and his sepulcher is with us unto this day." It's here. Everybody knew where it was. And they became fearful of doing any of digging into that tomb. And Josephus was born actually a few years after Peter was saying these words, speaking these words. So the people commonly knew where David's throne was at that time, and where the tombs of the kings were, but they don't know today. I mean, for almost 2,000 years, they have not known. Nehemiah, when he went back to build the second temple, helped build it, he talked about the place of my father's sepulchers. He knew exactly where they were. Nehemiah 2 and verse 13. He knew about where the fathers' tombs were. He knew that. And a lot of other people did. Norma Franklin, or an archaeologist, said this quote, this supports the assumption that the kings of the house of David were also buried in the royal palace. Well, they assume that, and I think it's more than just an assumption. I think it's more than just an assumption. But look, there is an archaeologist on this earth today, right now, that has already uncovered a great, well, at least a pretty good percentage of David's palace. Will those tombs of the kings be located right under that palace? There's a very good chance they will be. And Jeremiah prophesied that they are going to be found. They're going to be found. David's palace has already been found. And all we have to do is just believe God. Christ asked, though, the Son of Man comes, shall he find faith on this earth? And the answer was, there's going to be a world crisis in faith. But how about you? Do you really believe every word of God? Do you believe Jesus Christ? Until next week, this is Gerald Fleury. Goodbye, friends.
For more information on today's program, we have 3 reprint articles that we'd like to send you for free. These reprint articles cover the subjects of the Tomb of the Kings, the City of David excavations, and the mysterious prophecy of Psalm 83. This prophecy shows that Germany will be allying with several moderate Arab nations in the near future. As you heard on today's program, the 8th chapter of Jeremiah shows that the tombs of the righteous kings of Judah will be discovered before Christ's second coming. Do you have the faith to believe this prophecy? Our 3 reprint articles will give you the historical and prophetic understanding you need to prove God's word for yourself. Request our free reprint articles, which cover the subjects of the Tomb of the Kings, the City of David excavations, and the mysterious prophecy of Psalm 83. These reprint articles will be sent to you free of charge with no cost or obligation. It's free and invaluable information that you can't afford to be without. Operators are standing by to take your request. You'll also be sent a free subscription to our news magazine, The Philadelphia Trumpet. The Trumpet continues to help you understand your world by looking at today's most relevant headlines in light of Bible prophecy. Please visit us online at thetrumpet.com for daily columns and videos. Don't miss our latest issue with Gerald Fleury's article, The Mystery of the Royal British Throne. Other articles include, Are You Causing Climate Change? And Detroit Bankruptcy, Nothing to See Here. Request our free reprint articles, which cover the subjects of the Tomb of the Kings, the City of David excavations, and the mysterious prophecy of Psalm 83. You'll also be sent a free subscription to our news magazine, The Philadelphia Trumpet. All our literature is free. Order your free literature now.